Well, we've seen that the Thessalonian church was an exceptional church. They had received, of all the false gospels and religions of the day, they had received the true gospel from Paul and given evidence that they were chosen by God. They were sharing that gospel. They loved and were obeying the teaching of Christ's apostles. They were resolute in following Jesus, even under extreme persecution and difficulty. And Paul loved and had great affection for this church. However, the only problem with churches is it's made up of people. And you know that people are, well, people are just people. Only God is God. And so as a whole, they were a great church, but every congregation is composed of individuals in a church, and individuals and subgroups can pull away from the mainstream church. And that is what was happening in the Thessalonian church. They had a small subgroup pulling away from the main body and the main teachings of the church. These verses today, just simply, the more you study them, the more you realize they don't give you exactly what was happening. There's a lot of opinions what was happening. They were recorded for our instruction today because they detail how to handle those who disrupt the church. That's the emphasis in the passage. So we are in 2 Thessalonians. We're in chapter 3. And this week we're going to cover verses 6 through 10. Look there with me. Now we command you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep away from every brother or sister who's idle and does not live according to the tradition received from us. For you yourselves know how you should imitate us. We were not idle among you. We did not eat anyone's food free of charge. Instead, we labored and toiled, working night and day so that we would not be a burden to any of you. It is not that we don't have the right to support, but we did it to make ourselves an example to you so that you would imitate us. In fact, when we were with you, this is what we commanded you. If anyone isn't willing to work, he should not eat. So I want you to notice three sections in your outline on this. I think this breaks down into three areas of how to respond to church disruptors. Notice the first one. He gives a preeminent command. Avoid these people. Verse 6 again. He says, now we command you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to keep away from every brother or sister who's idle and does not live according to the traditions you received from us. Look at the importance of this command. It's a preeminent command. He distinguishes it among what he's been telling them. He sets it apart as exceptionally important. And I wrestled with that some. Look on your outline. Paul does not make this as a suggestion, nor is this his personal mandate. This is a command he imposed by the supremacy of Jesus Christ himself. Paul's been talking about his authority. He's been telling them how much he admires that they're obeying the word and they're not just hearing it, but they're embracing it and living it out. He even last week, we talked about the fact that he said, follow my commands. And we talked about his commands were those given by Christ who received, he said he did nothing that his father didn't tell him to do. But he treats this command on a different level. And you would struggle to see him treating something so highly when it seems to be maybe more of a minor problem with just a few people. But he appeals to Jesus Christ himself. He said, I command you under the supremacy of Jesus himself. Why was this so critical and preeminent of a command? Why did he emphasize it under the authority of Jesus himself? We don't know exactly. I think it's perhaps because this church was so strong. I don't know that he had messed with this in the church with Corinth. They were so carnal and worldly in some areas, even though they loved the Lord. But they struggled with such worldliness. This might not have been a major, but this church was so right in most areas. He did not want this little group to get any kind of a hold, because as you know, a small group can get a hold and it can become a cancer among the congregation. So I think he wanted it dealt with immediately with the highest authority that could be dealt with. Look at the command, verse 6. Look at the wording there in your outline. He said, keep away from these people. You can put a lot of different synonyms in there for that Greek word. Shun these people. Pull back from every believer who does not live by the systematic teaching of ethics that were clearly imparted by the apostles. I think he warned of something that has probably permeated our churches today and unfortunately not been heeded as importantly as he said it here. You can go to churches in a lot of places where the pastor gets up and preaches a very biblical message. He is preaching straight from the word and the command of God, but his congregation may be split in half, 50-50. Half of those people take those commands and they take them to heart and they say, we're called to obey them. The other half said, I just don't agree. We live in a different world today. It's a different culture today. I don't agree with what the pastor said. And the pastor said, I read straight out of the scripture. Well, I just don't agree with that. And so what they have is they have truth being taught, even as the apostle taught it, but they have two groups in the congregation, one rejecting those teachings, and they're a subgroup, and the other embracing those teachings, so they're just on a different page. And what happens with this group is Paul is teaching, and he's teaching the holy standards, but he expects the people to follow it. And so he's praising the church for doing so and following the supremacy and saying, separate, get away from, differentiate, identify clearly those who aren't with you. Now, some people would say maybe I push that. I make it very hard to sit in the middle and feel comfortable. But that's part of the reason, is that we're not called to just know the commands. It really means very little for someone to say, nice message, Pastor. I want them to say, that's a life-changing message, and I'm going to adjust some things. And when people say, you stepped all over my toes, I always say the same thing, good, because it worked me over all week before I was able to share it with you where it could do that too. So who was this group that he says, by the command of the Lord Jesus himself, shun, stay away, pull back, disfellowship with these people? It's the Greek word atactos. Notice atactos there that I have put in italics. It can mean that word is not one particular sin. It's a pretty broad taking of things. It can mean someone who's idle, or it can mean someone unruly. It can take a military connotation, meaning someone who's insubordinate or they've neglected their duty. There's multiple interpretations of what was happening. But what was universally accepted was that some were unethically using the church for their selfish gain and causing problems within the church family. So the dominant connotation is of the idol here. And if you were to read John MacArthur, he takes that particular translation, he'll build that under the problem not working. Let me give you a few breakdowns of what people thought might have been happening. Again, it wasn't one characteristic of this individual or individuals or this small group or subgroup. Some say it was a group of people living off the church rather than working and making their own living. They were depending too heavily. They were letting the church take care of them too much. Others say it represented a group that believed, a lot of the Greco-Romans believed that manual labor was very, very demeaning. And so they believe there was a subgroup that taught that Christians shouldn't have to do manual labor. Some believe that the generous in the church were supporting those who were not contributing, and they weren't reciprocating in any way, shape, or form. And then some think it was a patron-client situation. A patron, the society in that day was what was called a patron-client society. They didn't have government help like we have today, so you had people who weren't making it just like we have today, and the wealthiest were exceptionally wealthy, and they were expected to, and they gained status by supporting a sizable number of clients. So in that world in that day, your clients were social and economic inferiors who could even depend entirely on their patrons for daily sustenance. So you see what's happening there. Rather than a welfare system of the state, your wealthiest people would take care of those who couldn't quite cover it. And so some say it was an idea where these clients were just letting the wealthy take complete care of them, and they weren't taking care of themselves. So what it was, these people had diminished work and the importance of work and contributing, and maybe even neglected the responsibility to work entirely. So what we know is for sure the group was out of order. It was not following normal society norms that were expected of everyone to contribute in some way, shape, or form. So again, like I said, it's unclear what it was. You can read John MacArthur and he'll say one thing. You can read others. Most of them agree we don't know based on that word. It's such a broad, that word represents so many things. But based on what he says down later in verse 10, we know it has something to do with work. And they were being idle, but they were also pulling out as a subgroup and creating a lot of chatter and gossip and those things. So look on the screen. Here's the blunt side of who this group is. They were takers rather than givers. Common vernacular, we call them freeloaders, bloodsuckers, deadbeats. That's who Paul's talking about. And that's who he's saying, here's who I want you to discipline and how to do so. So what they were is they were in contrast to the life of Jesus. Jesus worked hard. They were a total contrast to Paul's life and his mission team's life. And Christ said, I came to serve, not to be served. And he washed feet, and he worked, and he constantly was moving along. Paul, the same thing. And Paul loved to identify himself. One of Paul's favorite terms was a bondservant of Jesus. I pride myself in just being a bondslave of my Lord Jesus to do whatever he wishes, whatever he desires, in the midst of that. So the believer shows obedience to the Lord and to the others by doing that. Look at the next point in your outline. When Paul states that those who go out from us, he says, in the name of our Lord Jesus, keep away from every brother or sister who's idle and does not live according to traditions you received from us. They've gone out from that. And I think that's a very important statement. When Paul states from us, he's conveying an isolated small group out of step from the mainstream congregation. Now, we've seen this in the Baptist church and every church for years. It's a little small group that pulls away. We note that many times it's very common. There's not a minister in the Southern Baptist Convention that doesn't know it just takes a handful of people can disrupt an entire church. They pull out, they start rallying, they start building a subgroup. They're insubordinate to the leaders, they're insubordinate to the direction of the mainstream church. They declare themselves authorities. They say, I alone in the authority, this is my Sunday school class, this is my small group, and the leaders of the church, nobody tells us what to do. This is our group, and they'll state that very emphatically. And so what they're boasting is that church leaders are not an authority over them. They're an authority. And they're a little different. And they'll say, we're marching to a little different drumbeat and we don't apologize. So they disconnect from supporting and serving alongside the mainstream church. What happens when that happens? Usually it's very common. The subgroups begins to critique the mainstream. They begin to critique the direction of the leadership and the mainstream, and they say there needs to be a call to action. We need to change some things. And they begin to call on the church and question what's going on. In my opinion, what is described here is exactly what's happening in the deconstruction movement that's taking place across the world. You may have never heard that. You can Google it. The deconstruction movement in the spiritual realm is people who, it is a rise of a group within churches that are deconstructing their faith. They're deconstructing the evangelical church, meaning they're rethinking everything. The government of the church, the leadership of the church, the message of the church, the makeup of the church. So they reject and they disconnect from long-held teachings and the structures and the practices related to faith in the church, sometimes no longer even identifying as a Christian. They said, the longer I began to look at how carnal the church is and this and that, and I began to deconstruct all of this, the more, in my mind, I reject everything that has been the standard and the traditions passed down from the beginning. Now, there's no one-size-fits-all in deconstruction. They can question some of the truths of the Bible. They can question the New Testament system of elders and overseers governing the church. They can question the Bible's teachings on what salvation really is. Someone who deconstructs might say, I reject a God who will send anybody to heaven or to hell. I just don't agree. And as I began to deconstruct that, I rejected that which I think I am smarter than the God who created those truths. So what do they do? What happens when individuals get together and start deconstructing? Look on the screen again. Birds of a feather flock together. They pull away. They're going to find their subgroup, whether they find a little bigger one in a different church or whether they go to some organization or something. They find a small and isolated sub-church of people. And my opinion is that this is not a process of deconstructing. In my opinion, what they're taking is the traditions given by the apostles, and they're apostatizing. They're falling away. They're simply apostates. And so Kerry Newhoff made this point. He said, unchecked deconstruction always leads to a deconversion from normative Christianity. Let me say that again. Unchecked deconstruction always leads to a deconversion from normative Christianity. That's what's happening here. And the problem, Paul says, is I expect it to happen, but y'all are letting it happen, and you're giving permission for them to take these stands and subgroups and those things, and you're not taking action. So Paul says, let me give you the example, what I want instead. He said, what's the example? It's us. Look at the example, point two in your outline, the Apostle Paul, verses 7-9. He says, for you yourselves know how you should imitate us. We were not idle among you. We did not eat anyone's food free of charge. Instead, we labored and toiled, working night and day so that we would not be a burden to any of you. It's not that we don't have the right to support, but we did it to make ourselves an example to you so that you would imitate us. Notice what Paul said. Paul said to imitate him just as he had Christ. Paul's life and testimony were in stark contrast to these subgroups and what they had done. He had a total different attitude of work and service and being insubordinate to the traditions that were the norms of the church and what Christ handed down. So look on the screen at what he said, how he contrasted to this group. He said, he and the apostles, his missionary team, they were not idle or unruly. He said, we weren't acting in a manner out of place among believers. We weren't stirring up things. We weren't creating gossip. We weren't tearing down. We weren't questioning the leadership and the direction of a good, healthy church. We had not pulled back. He said, we worked. We didn't sit and critique and divide. And so part of the reason he didn't have time to be unruly is look at the next point. He said, we paid for our own food. They perhaps even paid for their own lodging. They stayed with Jason, but the teachers of that day, remember, they didn't have TV, they didn't have news, they didn't have computer to get all the news. People would travel through and they would teach and they would give lectures. And when they traveled through, the community was expected to support them. Some manipulated the cities they went to, but not with Paul. He said, we paid for every bit of food we ate from you. We insisted on paying for our own food. They might have paid for their house and helped pay for the lodging even that it took to keep them. In fact, look what he stated about that. He said, we worked night and day to not be a burden to anyone. Paul said, we worked hard. We made our tents on the side and we'd work during the day so we could do our ministry at night. Or we would do our ministry during the day and we'd go straight home from ministering. We'd work at night. Now, we know for a fact that Paul later commonly asked for his churches to contribute financially. But what he's saying in our first presentation of the gospel, and because things had been so stirred up where we had just left, we didn't want to give any stumbling block to the reality and truth of the message we were giving you. We absolutely wanted nothing to convey that we were doing this for personal gain, just for you. So look at the next point. Though apostles and preachers are entitled to full support, you can read those passages later, it's grievously unacceptable for a minister to be lazy or aspire to gain rather than serve Christ and his church. I hope you sense that conviction among our staff. One of the difficulties your staff deals with is they're never off. They just don't get off. And it's not uncommon for them to do their work hours in the office, which they're expected to do. And then they may work through. It's not uncommon for these young staff to be up here. They work through until they have their night meetings. And then they'll have weekend ministries and things. Some of our young people are going 4 and 5 nights a week. And that's with working all their office hours and their duties on hand. You have a fantastic group of people. And they work hard. Most people don't realize, but based upon the ministry of church, a lot of staff can't plan ever a retreat or family getaway or anything without it coinciding with the church calendar. Robin and I haven't planned a vacation without the church calendar getting the first shot in I don't know how long. And she used to just get so frustrated with me. I said, dear, it just can't happen. It's got to be good for both. And so let's look at the main events and then let's fit in around it and we'll work it. So that's what we do. We change it up and we tweak it. She's fine with that now. That's what should be expected. And if you got a lazy minister, you should call us out on it. Not in a subgroup. Come to us. But Paul said we should be working and the Christians should be working. Everybody should work. Work is good. And we always tell young staff, we're not going to mark all your hours. But if you're lazy, you're just not going to be with us very long. Because the other staff will get frustrated with you, and I'll be frustrated with you, and we'll weed you out. And so they work hard. You got incredibly wonderful staff who work above and beyond their hours constantly and don't look and count the number of hours, make sure they get exactly their number of hours so they can go home. Finally, look at the last command. It was a pointed command. He says, listen, work. Verse 10. In fact, when we were with you, this is what we commanded you. We did it then, and I'm going to remind you. If anyone isn't willing to work, he should not eat. It doesn't get much more blunt than that. Notice in your outline, no work, no eat was a common expression of expected conduct among the Jews. In Christ's church, the maxim had been taught, this maxim had been taught and is canonized here as the command of the Lord himself. No entitlements are to be expected or granted to all who can work. These verses, along with some more instructions that we're going to see next week, lead many to believe that perhaps what was happening with this subgroup that isn't laid out clearly, but that they're just not working. And this isn't a hard command. It doesn't take a lot of theological study to understand what he's saying here. But realize it wasn't just an understanding or a statement. It's an expectation, and of the highest command you can give, it comes from the Lord himself. Every believer is going to work in heaven. You do know that. No playing a harp on the cloud. I don't know that I could bear that. I'm generally too active to sit on a cloud and play a harp very long, and my fingers would hurt. God's going to have jobs, but it's not going to come with the curse. It's not going to have the weeds and by the sweat of our brow. It's going to be fulfilling work and good work. If you're unwilling to work in society today, what work do you think Jesus is going to give you in his kingdom? Listen to this statement in Mere Christianity from C.S. Lewis. He said, if you want to get warm, you got to stand near the fire. If you want to get wet, you must get into the water. If you want joy, power, peace, eternal life, you must get close to or into the thing that has them. They're not a sort of prize which God could, if he chose, just hand out to anyone. They are a great fountain of energy and beauty spurting up at the very center of reality. If you're close to it, the spray will wet you. If you're not, you just remain dry. Once a man is united to God, how could he not live forever? Once a man is separated from God, what can he do but wither and die? I like that. Because get in, get involved, get connected. Church will never mean anything until you get connected to the people involved and find some area where you're doing that. Several ways we can respond. I'm going to list them real quickly, and then we'll take a minute. Find a biblical, active, unified church like the one in Thessalonica. Choose to obey the command of Jesus and pull back from people who simply critique, and they're outside and they pull in their subgroups and they critique everything going on, but they contribute nothing. The hardest people, if you want from a pastor's viewpoint to see the work of Christ, do the funeral of someone who's active in church and someone who never attends church. The person who never attends church will commonly with the church say, you didn't do this and this, and I expect this and I want this and that. The more active a person is, it's overwhelmingly humbling to me where they say, you just do anything, we're so grateful. Isn't that interesting? Ask any minister who does a lot of funerals, he'll tell you the same thing. It's the most giving, loving, sacrificial Christians who always expect the very least, even in their darkest moment of loss. Number three, expect your ministers to imitate Jesus. That's a fair expectation. Number four, don't be takers. Blessing, give to others. Teach your children and teens to work at home. We've just about quit making children ever work. We get a whole group of young people that are in their late 20s and they've never had a job, ever. But they want to lead a church, or they want to start as a manager at work. They've never cleaned the bathroom in their home. They've never mowed their grass. Teach your children the ethic of work. If you teach them to love and cherish work and you work beside them, they'll grow up and do that as well. Our ministers have an excellent watch. Our children, our youth, and our college students, I've never seen that whole group up contribute more to the church than that group does now. They are giving and giving, and our college students are tireless, and they're working in children's areas, and they're helping with this, and they're helping with that, and they're helping with planning, and then they're going to the BSM, and our group's helping lead in the BSM. They're everywhere. Our teens constantly, they don't plan to just come and have things for them. They have gatherings constantly where they go out and serve someone just in the community and share Christ. It's a beautiful thing to watch. And finally, don't enable anyone. Our culture has enabled a whole subgroup. It's going to take us down financially because we think it's biblical and merciful and good to give to people who give nothing in return. And we have a whole subculture in the nation and coming to the nation and growing numerically in the nation who could work, but they say, I won't work because I can get about the same thing for free. I'd rather stay home all day, every day. It's godless, it's unbiblical, and has no part in anyone who's a Christian. And so let's work and let's understand the joy of that. And let's be a church that doesn't let disruptors disrupt. Let's be a church of harmony and unity and glory to our Lord Jesus Christ. Will you bow your heads and close your eyes? Take a moment and pray. I'm going to give you a couple minutes to pray. And then I'll close us in prayer and Caleb's going to come up for a few minutes. So take a moment and pray and apply this as God leads. If you need to talk to someone at the sides, we'll have leaders at both sides of the worship center. Father, thank you for such a beautiful church. I love your people here. I commend them. I'm proud of them. Thank you constantly for them. I thank you for many who work constantly. I thank you for a lot who can't be too active in some things because their work calls them in so many other areas, but they're working too and presenting Christ everywhere. Father, if anyone is under conviction with this, I pray that you'd help them to just make the adjustments needed to be laborers and co-heirs and bond servants of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray these things in Jesus' name.